Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. And let me start by thanking the organizers for this opportunity to present the work of EFSA in the area of safety assessment of botanicals and botanical preparations. So if we go back in the past, actually, we started working as from 2006 on this issue, and this was mostly answering the needs expressed by the members of our advisory forum, meaning member states' competent authorities, for EFSA to prepare kind of a toolkit for the member states to look a bit at the safety of those botanical preparations that are marketed in their respective countries. Because, of course, you know that there is no really centralized safety assessment regulation, allowing for safety assessment at the European level for these types of products. So what we did is that we first published a guidance document explaining a bit what kind of data you would need for looking at the safety of those botanical preparations. And we also proposed a kind of a tiered approach for assessing the safety. In terms of data needed, it's you first need, of course, to start identifying what we are looking at, what you are talking about. So need for the scientific name of the botanical. We never use the common name, for example. Characterize which part of plant you consider, what type of extraction preparation process you will use. Then, in terms of the science-based framework for the assessment, we propose two levels. First level, where you consider only the data that are available, and this allows you to look at published literature, but also to consider the history of use of your plant preparation. So if there are no reported adverse effects, or if you have some substances of possible concern that have been identified, but you're able to say that they are below a certain level in your final product, you may be able to conclude already on safety without the need for further testing. So that's what we call the presumption of safety. Then if you're not satisfied with the data that are out there, you can always go to the level B, which means ask for additional data and evaluate them. Following the publication of this guidance in 2009, well, in parallel, actually, we also tested it with a group composed of experts of EFSA and representatives of the member states, and we had a number of case studies that are listed on the left, which is my right, and looking at different issues you may encounter with botanicals, possible of misidentification, adulteration of the product, case Camellia sinensis associated with liver toxicity, reproduction toxicity, the case where you have funiculum, where you have a genotoxic carcinogenic substances, etc., etc. So this was more to assist the users of the guidance to illustrate how you would use the approach developed by EFSA. And in parallel to this work, we started building a database, which we call Compendium, which is a database compiling, we started from the national list of plants. So some of them are positive lists, some of them are negative lists. And we looked for those plants, whether they contain some substances of possible concerns for human health, or whether they were associated with reported adverse effects. So in the end, we end up with a database where you have the scientific name of the plant, the family, the plant part where you may encounter substances of possible concern or that have been used in food, the substances of concern when they have been identified, or the reported adverse effects, some remarks that are relevant for risk assessment, and some bibliographies, reference books or some publications where we retrieved the most important information. We have already gone to version 2 of the compendium. It was published in May 2012. Okay, and I should mention that in this second version, we have two annexes. So we have the Annex A, there were a number of botanicals for which we could not find enough information about the substances of concern or the adverse effects. So those botanicals have been listed by a member state, either in a positive list or a negative list, but we are not sure about the rationale where they were listed, why they were listed. And we have a second annex that are botanicals for which there are data available in the literature, etc., but we could not identify any substance of concern or reason for including this plant in our compendium. So same thing here, it's listed by a member state somewhere, but we could not understand the rationale for putting this on a negative list or on a list with restricted use. Just now to update you, we are still working on this compendium and we are preparing a version 3, which will be expanded. You know that the parliament is looking very extensively at the new novel food regulation, and this foresees that what I call exotic countries, so non-European countries, would be allowed to put their plants that have a history of use in their country with just a notification process. So what we did is we started looking at Chinese list, Indian list, etc. And when those plants were not included in the compendium, we are adding now those plants in our compendium. And we will start looking a bit at what kind of information is present in the literature on these plants. The new thing is that so far it was an Excel-based version of the database, which is a bit difficult to handle, not very user-friendly. So we are transforming it into a more database format, which will be included in what we call the EFSA database warehouse, and it's a system that communicates. So the new thing is that the compendium will communicate with our other database, which is about chemical hazards. So when a substance of concern has been identified and there is an opinion on EFSA done by another panel on this substance, you will be able to retrieve very quickly if there is an ADI, what was the endpoint that was used to derive this ADI, etc. We decided to contract out the transformation part and the data collection for the compendium version 3, and we are just finalizing the kind of granting process of this work. And early January, so the successful contractor will start with this work with the objective that the transformation of compendium 2 into compendium 3 should be finalized by July 2016, 15, so next summer. And the contractor will continue gathering data, and we will keep now, once it's transformed, we can updating it much more regularly, and we will keep incorporating new data. One thing that is on which we have been working these last 2 years, and because when we, after the feedback we received on the, let's say, on the guidance document we published in 2009, plus having in mind this issue of exotic plants that will be notified at some point, or that we fear will be notified to us, we are a bit afraid of getting an avalanche of plants arriving on our head at some point, and we were requested if we could identify a way to kind of screen between those botanicals that have a long history of use, nothing really problematic, and that could be screened very quickly, so that we allocate the resources on the ones that pose actually, or that may pose more problems. And for those of you that are more familiar to the microbiology area, EFSA published an opinion on qualified presumption of safety. So it's a system that was intended for simplified assessment of microorganisms deliberately added to food and feed, to food for sure. And the idea is that because some of the bacteria or yeasts or they are stable in their genetic profile. The idea is that if you could assess the safety of a taxonomic group, the highest possible, so ideally a genus, a family, and based on the data available out there and the history of use, you can conclude on presumption of safety, then any species, subspecies, strain belonging to the same taxonomic group would be considered as safe without the need of further assessment. And this was our starting point, and we our task was to look whether we could apply this methodology to botanicals. So just to go back, so QPS is based on four principal considerations, the taxonomy, as I mentioned. So you need to have a clear definition of the taxonomic unit you're talking about. I refer you back to my guidance document about the importance of identifying really precisely the organism, the plant you're talking about, or the organism you're talking about. The second pillar is the body of knowledge. You need sufficient knowledge about the taxonomic group or the botanical you're considering. Toxicity, so if the taxonomic unit contains naturally occurring substances of concern, and if so, whether you know about their toxicity enough so that you can define a level, a dose under which there would be no problem, or an exposure level under which there would be no problem. And the importance of knowing about the end use. It's always the same thing. If a plant contains a substance of concern, but during your extraction process or your preparation process, of the, you don't extract the substance of concern, in the end product is not there. So there is no health, concern or no risk. So these are the two ideas. And this is the awful decision tree we managed to come to after almost 2 years of work. And there is a good reason for that, is that a botanical preparation is a mixture, complex mixture of different types of substances. So if you allow me, I will try to guide you through it. And so the first step, so this is the little arrows, step one, step two, is what I mentioned, and that is what is mentioned in our guidance document. Identify the botanical species, the plant part, and the preparation you're talking about. Second step, whether, and this is important, you need the compositional, the toxicological data. So you need really to characterize the composition of your preparation so that you're able to proceed with an assessment. If you're not able to get a proper characterization of the composition or an adequate, by definition, this excludes you for any further consideration for possible presumption of safety. And we had the question, what is an adequate characterization? Is it 80%, 50%, 90%? And here, I have no clear answer. I would say it's expert judgment. This is the magic word. When you don't know, it's expert judgment, okay? So when the experts looking at the safety of this preparation are confident that they are able to come to a conclusion with an acceptable degree of uncertainty, it's fine. And the reason why we need the characterization of the composition is because the specificity of a botanical is that you have a lot of variation. It's not like a bacteria, which is quite stable on one given substrate. The bacteria will produce the same kind of metabolites, while a plant, if you will get a huge variation in the composition if you cultivate it north of Europe, south of Europe, if you harvest it in spring, etc. So you get very different type of substances, and the levels of substances that are accumulated in your plant part of interest. So this is, I cut my awful decision tree. I started to cut it into various pieces, first because it's more readable, and then to show you that it's not that scary after all. So in your characterization, there is the ideal case, which means you have an adequate chemical characterization, no substances of concern, and no reported adverse effect. This is perfect. You can conclude on presumption of safety. And the step four, it was more related to this qualifying presumption of safety. So if you can conclude on presumption of safety for, let's imagine, a genus. So let's take Funiculum spp, which is a bad example, but let's take Funiculum spp. Then if I consider a species of this genus, am I able to come to the different type of conclusion? And that's a bit the reiteration where because this would save me some work for the future. So if I can grant this, or if I can convince myself about the presumption of safety at the genus level, any species or subspecies arriving later would simplify my work and I could conclude on presumption of safety. And the answer is that it does not work for funiculum, and we will see why. Then you have a bit other types of substances, which are the ones where you know about the structure, but you don't know about the toxicity profile. And here we have some tools like the QSAR system or the in silico read across approaches that would help you to try to characterize a bit the chemistry of this substance. So there will be two possibilities. Let me keep in mind that this is still to be implemented. We are still at the early stage of those methodologies. First, because you need to clearly identify the chemical structure of the substance you are talking about, and you need your QSAR model to be validated for those types of substances. The problem is that when it comes to botanicals, you have only limited analytical data most often. So this is how you could do it, but it does not mean that in the reality that will be so easy to do it. So when you do this QSAR thing, you will either arrive to some enough evidence or that you're persuaded that there is no, you cannot expect any health concern or reported adverse effects, so you end back to this situation. Or you will identify that your substance has a structure which is very close to another one, which could be considered as a substance of concern, which brings me to this one. So when it comes to substances of concern, then we need to differentiate between those that are thresholded, which means some health-based, established health-based guidance values like ADIs have been established, in which case you would come, you would still be able to come to a QPS or a presumption of safety with the qualification that your exposure in the end should be below this health-based guidance value. And then you have the case where you have no health-based guidance value, that's the one in the middle, and here you will have to consider the body of knowledge again, so what are the toxicity data out there, what's the history of use at the exposure levels you're considering, and then you will, if those data are there, you can still come to the QPS, so the presumption of safety with qualification. If not, your last chance is to use the TTC approach, but you know about the TTC that the concept is that there are three categories of substances, let's say, under very, very low levels under which you're sure that they are not of concern. In practice, for botanicals, it's not that useful because the levels we are talking about, then there is no point to put that in a food supplement because you would not have any beneficial effect or any effect you could expect. The last difficult case is that what we call non-thresholded substances. This is the particular case of genotoxic and carcinogenic substances. Again, you could consider the TTC approach, but keep in mind that there are a number of EFSA opinions, both in the food and feed area, that say that you should not introduce in the food chain substances for which you know that they are genotoxic and carcinogenic. So by definition for us, if it comes to genotoxic and carcinogenic compounds at levels higher than the one for set up at the TTC level, by definition, it cannot be granted presumption of safety, and this would require a full assessment and a really consideration whether you want to see those kind of substances on the market or not. So the iterative process, that's more what I tried to explain you, maybe it was not so clear. So once you have concluded on presumption of safety on species, you look at closely related species, whether you can expand this presumption of safety status, because the broader the group is, the easiest it will be for you if you receive a notification for a species a species belonging to this group, a subspecies, then you can conclude already on the presumption of safety without going for a full reassessment process. So when we finalized this work, we tried it with a couple of examples, and actually the QPS status could work, but at very low taxonomic levels, which makes it of very little use for EFSA assessment, because if you grant this QPS status at a species or at subspecies level, tomorrow, if somebody comes with another species, it will not belong to the same taxonomic group, and I will have to restart my assessment. So it's not really useful in terms of resource of optimization. And then we also figured out that there are very limited genus of families that show some stability in the composition that would allow that for which you would expect the same characteristic whether you consider different species of the same genus. So you have always this problem of variability in composition, which is really a pain in botanicals because each time you come with a new plant preparation which is completely different from what you have seen before. So it was half a failure in the sense that we did not arrive where we wanted, meaning to help our work in prioritizing the limited resources we have on the substances of interest. But it's not, I say, half a failure because still the awful decision tree I showed you has the merit to clarify what we meant in our guidance document, the level A on presumption of safety, because one of the comments we receive very often is, okay, but you mentioned, let's look at the body of knowledge out there, but how do I do it concretely? And this decision tree actually helps you to give you an approach, a methodology for looking at this available body of knowledge and whether you can arrive to a concept, a conclusion on presumption of safety or not. So we recommended all our panels and colleagues to use this scheme. For us, it's a way as well to get some feedback whether we did something wrong because, again, since there is no centralized regulation for us to assess the safety of plant-based food supplements, we will start with our colleagues on feed, for example, because they have plenty of plant notifications that are pending for assessment, so they can try this thing, and we are looking forward to get some feedback whether this decision tree needs to be corrected or not. And same for you, if you get a chance to look at plant preparation, and if you try this approach, if you see any limitation, things that could be improved, don't hesitate to send me an email because we are really keen on getting feedback if we can improve the tool. All the guidance document, ESCO report, testing the guidance document, compendium, QPS opinion, it's all available on the EFSA website, obviously. And I think that's it, what I wanted to say. Thank you very much.